morning, stand and take your songbooks in the row, page 481. Stand up for Jesus. We'll do all four verses of page 481.
Would you pray for us?
Lord, we thank you for this time that we gave your house. Lord, we pray this unto you. Lord, we just want to thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ who died on the Calvary for our sins and the apostle for us. We have returned to you. Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us, Lord, to worship you. We pray that everything is said here today.
right, you can be seated. Certainly good to see each of you here this morning in the Lord's house. And still got a number out due to COVID and different things, some traveling, but nonetheless, we are glad that you're here. Those watching online, we welcome you to our service as well. We're glad to be back. Lori and I and the boys had a good little mini vacation, we'll call it, little getaway to Grapevine, Texas at the Great Wolf Lodge. And if you have never been and you've got toddlers or children, you ought to take the time to go. It's a really neat place, Maddox. I mean, it was so fun to just watch Maddox run around and play. And we had a good time, got some rest. And so I appreciate you allowing us the time off. I appreciate Brother Mark filling in on Wednesday night in our absence. And I know that was a blessing. And I look forward to watching that service here just as soon as I can. Watch Brother Mark preach. Obviously, he's my favorite preacher, and I know he is many of you as well. So appreciate him filling in. We are glad to be back. Let me just make a few announcements, and I'll get right back into the song service here in just a second. Good to have some visitors. Good to have Miss Melanie back. Our friend Tim, I believe. Did I get that right? Good to have Mr. Tim from Vermont. And the great state of Vermont. Welcome to Houston. Welcome to Texas. And then other visitors as well. Good to see Karen here this morning. Not a visitor, but good to see her any time that she's here. And others as well. As far as announcements, let me just say, remind you ladies about the Bible study coming up. I think the first one is in November. Is that right? Okay, the first one's going to be in November. But there is a sign-up sheet for the ladies' monthly Bible study to reserve a copy of the book, the Bible study book. And so if you want a copy of that, then make sure you write your name. There is no cost. We've had one of our members who's going to cover the cost of the books, and so that's very generous, and we appreciate that very much. And I know you ladies appreciate that. So if you're going to attend the Bible study, then sign up and get a book. Make sure you do that. They will be handed out at the first session. So keep that in mind. I believe the first session is going to be at our house. But that'll be in November. The crib shower is still going on for Elizabeth Grace Shanks, Justin and Sarah Shanks' daughter. And she was born on September the 21st. And so if you would like to be a blessing to them and maybe get them some diapers or a gift card to help them in this stage, then that would be a blessing. I talked to Justin this morning. And they're looking forward to being back soon. He said they're finally getting back into a normal routine. So they'll be watching this service. We're praying for them. Look forward to seeing them. And so keep that in mind. The Rochesters will be with us here in about a month on November the 15th in the morning service. We'll let Brother Scott preach that morning. Let them sing all they want. Look forward to that. And then the very next day, on Monday, November the 16th, going through Wednesday night, November the 18th, we'll be having a meeting with Brother Steve Parrish, good friend of mine. He pastors the Greatest Mission Baptist Church. Now, that's a good name for a church, isn't it? The Greatest Mission. Brother Steve was a soldier. He's a veteran. Fought in war in Iraq. And so the church was planted and started by him after he got back from war. And really, it was started with a bunch of soldiers, were his first members, and so they named their church the Greatest Mission Baptist Church. And the church is thriving, doing really well there in my hometown of Pontotoc. Beautiful building, great location right on the highway. And notice I said the highway because there's only one highway there, but they're doing good. You'll love Brother Steve Parrish. If you hadn't heard him preach, all I can say is buckle up. And he is a fireball, but he'll feed you. He's very evangelistic. And I'm sure he'll share. I'm going to ask him to preach the sermon that he preaches about his experience there in war. And so that'll be a blessing. You'll look forward to Brother Steve. He's just a precious brother, one of my closest friends. He went to Canada with Brother Mark and I last February. And he was supposed to go to India with Brother Mark and I in June. That fell through, obviously, because of COVID. But I love traveling with him. And just a great friend, one of my heroes. I love him to death. You'll love him as well. So look forward to that. That's November the 16th through the 18th. And so that'll be here just a little over a month away. All right, if you are part of our text messaging group, and I think most of you are, you'll notice I sent a video out yesterday. Lord put this on my heart. As you've been aware, a little over 2 weeks ago, Brother Ken, Miss Debbie, welcomed the birth of their newest granddaughter to Michael and Chelsea, and Adeline Jane, or you can just call her Addie. And they found out about a week ago yesterday, she was having some breathing issues, took her to the ER a week ago. And long story short, she had to 2 weeks old, had to have open heart surgery on Wednesday. And she's doing well. They still, you know, still have a lot to go, an uphill climb certainly, but she is doing well, gaining her strength. Michael sent me a message the other day. He said she is his Addie Lion, and just a fighter. And so I thought that was appropriate. The Lord put it on my heart. Michael was raised in this church, grew up here, and all of you love Michael, know Michael, and maybe you don't know Chelsea as well, but if you know Chelsea, you love Chelsea. She's just a precious lady. We love her, love that couple. Let's help them out. We want to take up a love offering for them. They're going to have some major expenses, no doubt, medical expenses with this, and we're not going to pass the plate specifically for that, but you give, when you give your tithe and offering, if the Lord puts it on your heart to give, then just note that on the special offering box. You can put it on the, and obviously put your normal tithes and offerings and your special offering on the Lord's Supper table here below or in the box in the back. And let's be a blessing to them, and I know they're very grateful for that. All right. As far as other announcements, I don't know of any. If I think of some or some come to my attention, we'll get to that in a moment. We do have some birthdays. We missed one. Miss Debbie Owens had a birthday on October the 7th, so happy late birthday to Miss Debbie. And then on the 10th, Justin Shanks had one. That was yesterday. Happy birthday to Justin. On the 13th, Clifton Smith. I don't see Clifton. I think he's out of town. Brother Clifton has a birthday on the 13th of this week. And on the 17th, Haley Moore has a birthday. So happy early birthday to Miss Haley Moore. Any other birthdays or anniversaries that I'm not aware of? All right. No hands. Brother Ken, let's sing some more.
All right, Mama, she gets out of it because she's in the nursery all the time. Let's sing happy birthday to Debbie.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
All right, take some. It's page 495. Heaven came down. All three verses of page 495. 495.
Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day. Day I will never forget. After I wandered in darkness away, Jesus my Savior I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend. He met the need of my heart. Shadows dispelling with joy I am taken.
as well with my soul. We're going to do all four verses, page 493.
Who writes a symphony?
lights every star that makes our darkness bright. He keeps watch all through each long and lonely night. He still finds the time to hear a child's first prayer. Saint or sinner, call and always find him there. Though it makes him sad to see
every time Brother Ken sings, but that's one of my favorite ones that he sings. I love that song. Thank you, Brother Ken. That's a blessing. Mark's Gospel, chapter 4 this morning. I invite you to take God's Word. So we're studying the book of Mark, looking at the life of Christ in the book of Mark, just following the footsteps of Jesus. So I invite your attention to Chapter 4 of Mark's Gospel. We'll begin our reading in verse number 1 here in a moment. Let me begin by way of introduction by just telling you that there is a real danger of coming to church, growing up in a Christian environment, maybe coming to church all of your life, perhaps every Sunday, and hearing sermons until you have no ears to hear with. And that's exactly what we find in Mark chapter number 4 that happened to the Pharisees. If you'll remember last Sunday morning when we were in the text, we dealt with the subject and answered the question of, is there a sin that God will not forgive? The danger of that sin that God will not forgive, understand that Christ was talking about the Pharisees. The problem with the Pharisees is that they had heard the Bible, they knew the Word of God, they had learned it. They've been taught it their whole life. You ever gone out to share the gospel with a lost man or a lost woman and they said something like this? I grew up in church. I went to church most of my life as a boy, certainly. I learned all those scriptures. I can probably quote many of those scriptures better than you can. And yet, perhaps they even begin to quote scripture and yet they're just as lost as can be without Christ. Their life is in darkness. You see, the problem is he experienced the danger of hearing, but not hearing. having ears, but yet did not hear. He heard all of those things, but rather than putting him in light, those things put him in darkness. And that's the way the Pharisees were. They were the ones that Jesus referred to that were in danger of committing that unforgivable sin of blaspheming the Holy Spirit, because they had heard it and they had heard it and they had heard it until their hearts were no longer receptive to hearing the truth. So Christ comes along in Mark chapter number 4 in order to extend His love, extend His grace to those that had heard the gospel so many times and yet had not heard it, had not understood it, had not received it. Christ comes along and He begins to teach in parables. And we know what parables are. They're earthly stories that have a heavenly meaning. And Jesus would use these very simple illustrations to illustrate profound spiritual truth because of His love. And when Jesus could not reach them one way, then He started trying to reach them another way, and He used the method of the parable. And so this sermon is often titled the Sermon by the Seaside. You've heard the Sermon on the Mount, you know of it, but perhaps you didn't know that this was the Sermon on the Seaside, and that's exactly what it is. And so let's begin our reading in Mark chapter number 4, verse number 1. The Bible says, "And He began again to teach by the seaside. And there was gathered unto Him a great multitude, so that He entered into a ship and sat in the sea, and the whole multitude was by the sea on the land." And so He's on the water. He's in a boat, and the boat is His pulpit. And the congregation, the audience, if you will, is on land. Verse 2, "And He taught them many things by parables, and said unto them in His doctrine, Hearken, behold, there went out a sower to sow. And it came to pass, as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and the fowls of the air came and devoured it up. Some fell on stony ground, where it had not much earth, and immediately it sprang up, because it had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, it was scorched, and because it had no root, it withered away. Some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up, and choked it, and yielded no fruit. Others fell on good ground, and did yield fruit, that sprang up and increased, and brought forth some 30, some 60, some 100. And he said unto them, He that hath ears to hear, let him hear." Let's stop there just for a moment. Now, all of these folks obviously had physical ears. But Jesus was saying, if you really have ears to hear, then please hear what I'm saying. Hearken unto me. And that is the impact of the whole fourth chapter of the Gospel of Mark. The responsibility of hearing the Word of God. The danger, if you will, of hearing sermons with physical ears, but not having spiritual truth or spiritual ears to accept spiritual truth. And what Jesus is saying is, if you have ears to listen, then open up your ears, open up your heart. And notice verse number 10, he says, "And when he was alone, they that were about him with the 12 asked him the parable. And he said unto them, Unto you it is given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God, but unto them that are without all these things are done in parables. That seeing they may see and not perceive, and hearing they may hear and not understand, lest at any time they should be converted, and their sins should be forgiven them. And he said unto them, Know ye not this parable? And how then will ye know all parables?" Now Jesus was not saying here that he didn't want them to hear. He's not saying that he didn't want them to understand. But what he's saying here is that prophecy must be fulfilled. As a matter of fact, the Bible predicted in the book of Isaiah that the religious leaders during the time of the Messiah would hear, but they wouldn't hear. They would hear, but they wouldn't understand. They would see, but they wouldn't really see the spiritual reality, and they would not be converted, and they would reject Christ as the Messiah. And so he's not saying here that he doesn't want them to hear, that he doesn't want them to be forgiven, but he's teaching them in the very simplest form possible so that they will have every opportunity possible to be saved. And yet even after he gives them every opportunity, they reject him as Lord, as Messiah. Church, ladies and gentlemen, listen to me. One of the greatest tragedies of life today in our city, in our state, in our country, is that people of the United States of America have gone to church, and they have gone to church, and they have gone to church, and they've heard sermon after sermon after sermon, and yet it has not changed their life. hasn't changed their life. It hasn't changed their lifestyle. It hasn't changed their sense of direction. It hasn't changed their character. They continue to hear sermons, but it seems like the more sermons they hear, the greater darkness many people experience. And so in this passage, again and again and again, Jesus indicates for you and I to be careful how we hear. Be careful that you not only hear with the physical ear, make sure you're getting it with your spiritual ear. You know, as you look at a congregation or a crowd, and it really doesn't matter how small or how large it is, there's no way a preacher can really tell who's hearing, who's listening, who's receiving the Word of God. You can appear to be hearing the Word of God and yet not really hear it. Now, there are some that are obvious. Obviously, if you're asleep, then it's pretty obvious you're not hearing the Word of God. Or if young people are passing notes to one another, or you got a young couple and they're just in love and all they do is stare at each other, then you know they're not hearing the Word of God. But, you know, there are many people that seem like they're into it. And yet you cannot tell if they're really receiving the truth of the Word of God. And so that's why Christ cautions us in this passage, because He tells us that we will be responsible one of these days for what we hear. Jesus goes on in this chapter to indicate to us that if you reject the truth of God that you understand, then friend, it's going to limit the truth of God that you can receive in the future. For instance, down in verse 24, I think it is, the Bible says, He said unto them, take heed what you hear. With what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you. And unto you that hear shall more be given. Friends, some people cannot grow in the Lord. They cannot continue to advance in their Christian knowledge of Christ. And the Bible says it's because they weren't receptive to the truth that they do know. Understand, friend, that God will not give you and I more truth until we begin to obey the truth that He's already given us. A lot of people want to know the Bible, and they'll make statements like, oh, if I could only understand the Bible. Oh, if I only knew what this was about. Why can't I understand the Bible? I can tell you for the most part why you can't understand the Bible. It's because you're not obeying the part you do understand, friend. And until you come to the place in your life where your heart becomes good soil into which the seed of the Word of God can be planted and grow unhindered, then you'll never know what it is to understand and unlock the great truths of the Word of God. So Jesus, in this passage of Scripture, warns about the danger of coming to church. I heard about a man who's just rebellious. He's a member of a church on the church rolls, but he never came. It had been ages since he came to church, and the pastor kept inviting him to church, and he just always had an excuse. And so one day the preacher goes by on a Monday and he says, man, I want you to come to church. You weren't at church yesterday. We missed you yesterday. Where were you? And he said, well, preacher, I've got a real good excuse this time. He said, man, it's just so wet. It was raining all day. And man, the streets were flooding. The ground was so wet. He said, I couldn't come because all of the water. And the preacher said, well, it was real dry at the church house. And he said, yeah, and that's the second reason I didn't come. You know, that maybe, you'll get that in a moment, that may be the reason for you not coming, but whatever reason people give for not coming, understand it's dangerous to come to church and listen and hear and yet not listen and not hear with spiritual ears. Let me show you three things from this wonderful little story that Jesus gave us. And by the way, if you've got a garden or something like that, then this will be maybe some good news for you, a little help in the agricultural background. And so Jesus is in a boat for His pulpit. The congregation is on the seashore of the Sea of Galilee. What a beautiful time it would have been. I believe perhaps Jesus, as He's standing on the boat, looks to the hillside and probably saw a very common sight. May have saw a sower going out to sow. A farmer walking, and he had a bag on his side full of seed, and he's ready to sow that seed in his field. And so Jesus perhaps points over to the farmer, and He says, behold, a sower went forth to sow, and he sowed some of the seed, and some fell on the wayside ground, and some fell on the thorny ground, and some fell into the good ground, and so on. You get the picture that Jesus is giving a very simple illustration to illustrate a very profound spiritual truth. Now, the first thing that I want you and I to see here is the responsibility of the sower. He said that the sower went forth to sow. Drop down to verse 14 and following, and He explains the parable, and He explains here that the sower is the Lord Himself. Jesus came into this world to sow the seed of the Word of God. Everywhere Jesus went, he's scattering seeds, scattering the seeds, scattering the good news that one day would bring about an abundant harvest. You know that you and I are servants of Christ. This picture is the servants of Jesus. What are we to do? Friend, we are to sow the Word of God. Now, that doesn't mean that we only sow it from the pulpit, but certainly there are hundreds of ways that we can sow the seed. How are we to sow the seed? Well, number one, we're to sow it plentifully. Plentifully. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians, if you take notes, you might jot it down. In 2 Corinthians 9:6, he which soweth sparingly will reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall reap bountifully. What does it tell us? Tells us that if we want to reach a lot of people for Christ, if we want a great deal of spiritual fruit, if we want to see God work in a mighty way, then we need to sow plentifully. Plentifully. We don't need to be stingy. Well, we don't need to be little in our thinking when it comes to sowing seeds. Folks, we need to broadcast the seed of the gospel everywhere we go in every possible way we can. We do that by YouTube and on our website. We do it through Grace Bible School. We do it through Star of Hope. We do it through CCA and nursing home ministries and through our mission program, through our mission trips. We sow it by giving out gospel tracts. We sow it by making visits, by making phone calls, in our personal everyday evangelism when you're out and about at work or wherever you go. We sow it in a million different ways, but understand the more we sow, the more people we have sowing the seed, the more plentifully we sow the seed, friend, the greater the harvest will be. It really is exciting in my mind to think about the potential of the harvest that the Parkwood Baptist Church could have if the people of God would come together and understand that it's our responsibility to sow the seed of the Word of God plentifully. Boy, I want a big harvest. I think you want a big harvest. And if that's the case, we need to sow a lot of seed. A lot of seed. Not only are we to sow plentifully, but we are to sow the seed passionately. Jot down in your notes Psalms 126, 6. The Bible says, "He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him." Now, I love that phrase, "He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed." You know, one of the things you can do when you're gardening, my granddaddy used to tell us this. We always had a garden growing up. My papa, he's passed away now. You met his widow a couple of weeks ago, my grandmother. But he used to say, for certain kinds of seeds, if you want these to produce faster and better, he said, soak them in water right before you plant them. Listen, that ain't going to cost you a dime, but it's a wonderful truth that ought to help you. But it's absolutely right. And here's the picture of the seed being watered by the tears of the sower. He that goeth forth and weepeth. I believe with all of my heart that a lot of people are not as productive as they ought to be with the seed because they have no compassion for the souls of mankind. I'll be honest, brutally honest, I am absolutely astounded at the lack of concern and the lack of love and the lack of tears that the people of God have for a lost and dying world. And yet the Bible says if we water our seed with tears, if we'll have a real concern and a real love and really care for lost people without Jesus, then we'll have a wonderful harvest of souls and it'll bring honor and glory to the Lord Jesus Christ. All I'm saying is sow the seed passionately. But then we're to sow it patiently. Galatians 6:9, "And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not." Boy, it's so easy to get discouraged, isn't it? It's so easy to get discouraged, to teach a Sunday school class week after week after week, and to preach week after week after week, and you're sowing seed, and you're sowing seed, and you're sowing seed, and it seems there's no harvest, there's no fruits being produced, or maybe they're just being produced in a very small way. It is so easy to get discouraged sowing the seed. Yet Paul wrote to the Galatians and he said, listen, you got to be patient. You got to be patient. You don't sow a seed one day and harvest the next day. You got to wait for the germination process. And that's the way it is in stewardship, friend. A lot of people say, well, I believe God's going to return unto me a great blessing, and so I'm going to give today. And tomorrow they look for a fat check in the mail. It doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. God, the Bible teaches you to sow patiently. You've got to have patience. Bible says if you are patient, if you endure, if you'll continue, if you won't give up, then in due season we'll reap if we faint not. Friend, I am here to tell you on the authority of this book that is the method of God, and it will not fail. It is absolutely foolproof. Friend, if you do the work of God faithfully, and you do it patiently, God will bless your life and God will make you fruitful and there will be a great harvest of God. Friend, it is the responsibility of the sower to sow seed, to do it plentifully, to do it passionately, to do it patiently, to wait upon the blessings of God. But not only does he mention the responsibility of the sower, but he talks about the reliability, and I love this, the reliability of the seed. The seed, of course, is the Word of God. And as you look at the Word of God being a seed, first of all, we see that it is a wonderful seed. The Word of God, isn't it amazing that the Word of God that was preached 2,000 years ago and brought a result then can be preached today and get the same result? As I was preparing this, I come across a story. I was told that archaeologists discovered in a pyramid in Egypt a little jar, a little vase of seeds. And these seeds were more than 3,000 years old. Can you imagine that? Seeds being locked away for 3,000 years. Yet when they took those seeds, those little tiny seeds, and they planted those seeds that were at least 3,000 years old, locked inside of a vase, they found out that locked inside those seeds was life. And they got buds, and they got sprouts, and they got a plant from seeds that were locked up 3,000 years ago. Let me tell you something about the Word of God. It's wonderful because it never changes. Never changes. It brings forth the same result today as it did when Jesus preached it. It is wonderful. It is infallible. It is the reliability of the Word of God. But not only is it wonderful, it's powerful. It's powerful. There is power in the Word of God. One fellow had a New Testament, and it was a pocket New Testament. It was small, and it didn't have enough room on the cover to write the New Testament because the Bible was so small, and so he just had TNT put on it. Brother, I want to tell you, that's exactly what I've got in my hand and what you've got in your hand. TNT, dynamite. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It's the power of God unto salvation for everyone that believeth. And the word for power there is the Greek word dunamis, where we get our word dynamite. Friend, this book has power. This book is powerful. I can stand up here and I could take Shakespeare's greatest writings and give an invitation and read Shakespeare's writings, and I truly believe that not a single person would come and say, oh, Shakespeare was so wonderful, I was inspired to give up alcoholism or put the drugs down and come to God. That would never happen. That would never happen. I could stand up here week after week after week and read the greatest works that literature has ever known, and you might be inspired in a sense at the gift of the author, but I don't believe for a single second that a single life would ever be changed or a single person would ever be saved from the shackles of sin. But I believe with all of my heart that we can get behind this sacred desk with this TNT and preach the Word of God week after week, and God can bless His Word because there's power in the Word of God. It's wonderful. It's powerful. It's fruitful. Brings forth fruit. It brings forth life. You go into an orchard and there you can get an apple, and that's wonderful. It's wonderful to find an apple in an orchard. But Jesus said the Word of God is like a seed. The wonderful thing is there's an orchard inside that apple. My friend, you preach this Word of God, you plant one seed. And who knows? Who knows how much fruit? Who knows what God is going to do with one seed that's planted? If I were to ask you individually, probably some of you would have to admit to me this morning that you don't think you've ever won a soul to Christ. I believe with all of my heart, if you're faithful, some of you are going to get to heaven and you're going to be amazed and pleasantly surprised, because you're probably going to meet people in heaven and they're going to approach you and say, I'm in heaven because you planted the seed of the Word of God. And you didn't think anything took place, and you didn't think there was going to be a harvest, but God blessed that seed, and I now have life because you planted a seed. Ladies and gentlemen, there is power in this book because it's fruitful. It's like a seed that brings forth life. A seed is very tiny. Seems to be so insignificant. You can put this book, the Word of God, in the greatest library in the world. Put it in a room written with all volumes of literature, the best that have ever been written, This one book alone will overpower every single one of them. Every one of them. Because it, within the pages of this book are life-giving power, the message of Jesus Christ, the reliability of the seed. That brings me to my third and final point. Not only do we see the responsibility of the sower and the reliability of the seed, but I see the receptivity of the soul. The soul needs to be receptive. And notice this, what he said in this particular passage as he talks about how receptive the soil can be. He talks about four kinds of soil. Everyone listening online and everyone in this auditorium, you are one kind of soil or another. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. Everyone here, you may be one kind of soil in the process of moving to another kind of soil, but the soil is the human heart. Jesus said there are four kinds of responses to the Word of God. First of all, he speaks and he talks about the heart that is hard, the wayside heart, the unreceptive heart. Notice what he says here. He calls it wayside ground, the human heart that's represented by the wayside ground. He talks about how some of the seed fell upon the wayside. What is the wayside? Well, the wayside is the pathway in which the sowers would walk through the field as they sow the seed. And so every day it had hundreds and thousands of footsteps on it, and it was just beaten until it was as hard as concrete. Now, some of you are like that. People I know are like that. People you know are like that. And do you know what makes your heart hard? Friend, the thing that makes your heart hard is what you've allowed in your heart. What you've opened your life up to, what you've opened your heart up to, the false ideologies of Satan, all the false philosophies of this world, the secular, the materialistic thinking of this age. And you've searched on Google and you've watched television and you've been pounded, and the soil of your heart has been pounded and pounded and pounded by all the false ideas that the devil will throw your way, and the fact that there's pleasure in sin, that you're going to be able to find contentment in material success. And until you come to church on Sunday morning and we sow the seed, and the seed falls on a hardened heart, wayside ground. It falls on a heart that's been so hardened by the philosophies in the culture of this age and the ideas of the devil and the things of this world. And the devil's got his little birds waiting around. And the Bible says the birds come and the devil's birds come and they pick the seeds up off the soil, off your heart. So what happens? Well, the seed doesn't take root. Matter of fact, the first three soils that he mentioned, none of them are saved people. None of them. What happens is the Word of God did you no good. You didn't receive the Word of God. Listen, the Word of God isn't going to help you unless the Word of God gets into your heart. Unless it gets into your heart. On top of your heart, there's no value whatsoever. It must get deep down inside of you. It must do the work of germination to bring forth life. And man, some of you, your heart is so hard. Listen to me. Listen to what I'm saying this morning. Jesus said, if you have ears, hear. Some of you perhaps have even joined a church, made a profession of faith, but your heart was hard. You came down an aisle, you joined the church, you made a religious decision. And yet you're on your way to hell this morning because you've never truly received the Word of God. Your heart's never been changed. And it's just as hard as the asphalt on Aldine Bender outside the door there. And you're lost and you're going to hell. These Pharisees were exactly like that. Years of religion had hardened their heart and they weren't open to the gospel. And Jesus said, because you're not open to the Holy Spirit, one of these days you're going to blaspheme the Holy Spirit. You're going to say no for the final time. And you're not going to hear the message. And when that takes place, friend, you're going to die lost. So there's this unresponsive hearer, the person who has a heart that's unresponsive because it has been hardened. Friend, God made your heart to be tender. God made your heart to be sensitive, to be receptive. And you were made by God to have a heart that's open to the Word of God. But because of circumstances and you allowing things into your heart, it's been hard. You say, how long does that process take? I think it's different for every person. You may be 60, 70, 80 years old and your heart just now beginning to get hard. Yet on the same hand, you may be 15, 20 years old and your heart may be hard. I remember when I was at Essary Springs there in Pocahontas, Tennessee. When I first got there, there was a family, a good family, members of the church. There were no deacons in the church, a small church, you know, maybe 20 or 30 people, and none of the men were qualified. Most of them were divorced and remarried. But they did have a leadership committee of about three or four men. And the family I'm referencing, the father was on that leadership committee, a good man. I enjoyed my time there and our fellowship and our friendship. They're no longer members of that church. Tragedy happened in their life and they got out of church. They had a son, well, they had three kids, and their oldest was a son. His name was Andrew. Andrew was perhaps, 15, 16, 17 years old. He was in high school. Andrew was a good-looking boy, handsome boy. He's a good athlete, played basketball and baseball, very popular at school there in Middleton, Tennessee. And Andrew was there every Sunday, never missed, only because Mama and Daddy made him, drug him there. You would have liked Andrew. Andrew was a likable guy. He was, you know, he was funny, had a good personality, he was outgoing. But you could just tell every time I was in the pulpit preaching, he had his head down. He wasn't paying attention. He wasn't in it, if you will. His daddy would talk to me from time to time. I remember at least two or three occasions specifically where his father would meet with me and say, "Pray for Andrew." Man, we have our devotion at night. We try to talk to him about the Lord. He just shows no interest whatsoever. And I don't know if it's mistakes that we made parenting or what, but he's respectful, he's fine, but he's giving us some trouble. And he's getting in trouble at school. He's getting in trouble. He had gotten in some trouble with some girls, and he just wanted prayer for his son. He said, "The Lord needs to save him. Pastor, the Lord needs to save him." I said, "Well, I will." I tried to talk to Andrew from time to time, and he was very respectful, but he just showed no interest in the things of God. Well, I left the church. Obviously, I moved here, and I got word shortly after I moved here that Andrew was killed in a car accident, lost his life. Friend, if you are in that position, no matter if you're 15 or 20 like Andrew, or 75 or 80, friend, you're in a dangerous position. Dangerous position. Andrew had hardened his heart. He had allowed things to come into his life, ideologies and the culture and sin, and his heart had hardened. And friend, God has come in the Holy Spirit. And if your heart is like that, you're in a dangerous position, because God has to come inside with the Holy Spirit and plow up your heart. And let me warn you, it's a painful, painful process. It may hurt, because God will have to dig the plows real deep into you, the hardness of your heart, to plow it up. And every time you hear the gospel and you reject it, and every time you hear the truth and you turn away from it, your heart becomes that much harder. That much harder. Not only that, not only the wayside ground. Notice the stony ground. I call the wayside ground the unresponsive heart. There's just no interest there. But notice the stony ground, and it's the impulsive heart. Notice in verse 16, "And these are they likewise which are sown on stony ground, who when they have heard the word immediately receive it with gladness, and have no root in themselves." Stop there for a moment. Stony ground, a shallow soil, if you will. It was a rocky soil, had a layer of rocks underneath the soil. And so the seed would fall on the stony ground, it would germinate, it would spring up, but because it had no root, it would die, it wouldn't last. You folks here and even listening online need to listen to this. If you've got an ear to hear, then you need to hear. Some people say, "Brother Wesley, why is it that someone can come down an aisle? They're so excited about Jesus. They're going to be the next Billy Graham. They're going to win Houston to Christ. They come to church and they're here for, and some of you have been here 20, 30, 40, 50 years, and these guys come and all of a sudden they're going to show you why you hadn't done a better job of building the church and reaching people for Jesus. Then in 6 months, they're gone. Or a year, they're gone. What happened? They lost that enthusiasm. What happened? According to this parable, they were lost. They're lost. The seed didn't get inside. There was no depth. They acted on emotion. Let me tell you something, friend. Every spiritual decision involves three things. It involves the mind. It involves the emotion, and it involves the will. And if you make an emotional decision and you come down an aisle and you say, well, hot diggity dog, I'm gonna get on the gospel train and I'm gonna begin to serve Jesus and I'm gonna win this city for Christ, and you don't really have a spiritual birth, you don't receive the Word of God into your heart, you are not going to last. It's not going to last. Oh, you'll spring up and you'll look great for a little while and you'll look like you're doing something. But friend, it will not last, and you'll die and you'll spend an eternity without God, because the seed did not get off the top ground. It didn't get off the top. It fell among the stones and it didn't get in. And understand, unless it gets in, you cannot be saved. Didn't think I'd get many amens this morning. A lot of people like that who have made a superficial decision and yet they didn't last. I could call names, you could call names, of many today who came down the aisles of Baptist churches, perhaps even this Baptist church, and they made a kind of decision, an emotional decision, but it did not last because it was on the basis of impulsiveness. They're the same people who hop on every train that drives by. They jump on every fad that gets popular. They're church hoppers. They get into every new fad. They get on every new diet that they can think of, and they think, I'm going to lose all this weight. And they do lose 1 million pounds in their lifetime because they lose and gain, lose and gain, lose and gain. My friend, I want to tell you, serving Jesus is much more than emotional. Much more. And when the emotional is gone, friend, if that's all you've got, you'll drop out. You won't last. Some of you have had that experience, and you're back this morning. And if that be the case, you need to hear the Word of God. Let it get in your heart. Get something that's real. Get rooted and grounded in the Word and experience Christ. The third kind of soil, I've got to hurry. It says some fell among the thorns, and pretty soon the Bible says those thorns began to choke it out. And Jesus said this refers to those to the cares and the pressures and the worries of life. But again, it had no root. So other things came in. Now, Jesus wasn't number one, Jesus wasn't Lord. Jesus wasn't preeminent, and so it was stifled, and the Word of God was choked out by the things of this world. And man, there are a lot of people like that. Listen, the Bible's very, very plain that the road to heaven is narrow, and few be there that find it. Some of you better listen to me right now, because the world has choked out the Word of God in your life, and Jesus isn't preeminent, and He isn't number one, and you've got a superficial kind of religion, and if that be the case, friend, that religion is not going to get you to heaven. It's not. Jesus said when you have this kind of religion, eventually your heart's going to take a back seat. Jesus is going to take a back seat. I told you a decision involves your head, it involves your emotions, and it involves your will. And a lot of people say, yes, I need to be saved. And emotionally they say, yes, I need to be saved. But they never yield their life and their will to Christ. And the Word of God never truly gets in. Christ never gets in. But thank God there's a fourth kind of soil. And it's the kind of person who is truly saved. And I want you to see this fourth kind of soil. He talks about this good ground, and he says some of the seed fell on good ground. And in the good ground, it found root and it found life and it produced the fruit of the Spirit of God. And I'll tell you, friend, listen to me, where there's no fruit, there is no root. And if there's no root and if there's no fruit, then friend, there's no salvation. You'll never get a person, who makes an emotional decision to be a tither. You'll never get a person who made a superficial decision to be a soul winner. You'll never get a person who made a decision and had a hard heart to be a prayer warrior. You won't. You'll never get people who were never saved to grow spiritually. There cannot be spiritual growth until there's, first of all, spiritual life. And Jesus goes on in this passage to explain to us that if a person is truly saved, I think it's around verse 26, that if a person is truly saved, then spiritual growth will come as a natural result of their salvation. And friend, there are a lot of things we can do to help people grow spiritually, and we need to do more of it. But the first thing you do is you've got to get them saved. They must be born again. You've got to get people born again, because you cannot grow life until there's, first of all, life. A baby can't become an adult until, first of all, he becomes an infant. A corn crop's not going to yield the fruit of corn until it first comes up as a stalk and as a plant. But if a person is truly a child of God, they will bear fruit. The great evangelist Billy Sunday used to preach, and he would say on a number of occasions, I hear preachers talk about worldly Christians. He said, man, that's like talking about heavenly devils. In other words, the Bible teaches that the Christian life is a supernatural life. It is a changed life. And this morning, as I close this message, I just ask you, and I'm done. What kind of ground is your heart? What kind of ground is your heart? With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, Brother Ken, you and our musicians come. I wonder, have you really heard the Word of God? Have you really heard it? Have you received it? Or has your heart been wayside ground? Hard. Hard. And as soon as the message comes, it does you no good because the devil takes it away. Your heart is so hard that the seed can't sink in. Or is your heart stony ground? God speaks to you and you feel emotionally what you ought to do. But as soon as the emotion is gone, you won't be found faithful. Or is your heart thorny ground? You hear the word of God, but there are so many things in your life that you're not willing to give up. And the word of God can't take root. Therefore, there's no fruit in your life. Or I wonder, is your life like that soil that's ready, that's softened, that's been prepared, that's receptive? The Word of God finds it, and you're saved miraculously. Born again by the power of God, by the power of the Word of God and the Holy Spirit, and fruit is found in your life. You're one of the four. All of us are. And only you know the answer. So I ask you very bluntly this morning, are you saved? Do you know Christ as Lord and Savior? Trust that you are. If you don't, friend, you ought to come and make a decision today. Not just an emotional decision. But a decision with your heart that you're going to follow Christ. You want Him to be the Savior of your life. Our Father, I bow in Your presence. Thank You for the Word of God, for the people of God. Bless this invitation. Save that one that's closest to hell this morning. Amen. You got a number there.